Welcome everyone to Sunday Online from the Free. It's great to have you all joining us, and particularly to the men tuning in to watch. Happy Father's Day. Hope you are feeling appreciated and blessed today.
And I thought that we'd begin with some verses from John chapter 3, which talk about the incredible love that our Heavenly Father has for us in sending Jesus to us. It says this: "For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict: light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be plainly seen that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." And Father God, we want to thank you today especially for your Father's love, and Lord, for this incredible generosity in sending your only Son to be our Saviour, to bring light into this dark world. We praise you, we worship you, and we invite you, Holy Spirit, to shine your light on us as we join together now in worshiping you. Amen.
It's falling from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and rain. It's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. The music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, great.
Declare
see the moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you. And you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still
some things that we would love to share with you. And the first one is that we are going to be running our course, Discovering the Free, in a few weeks' time. This is a great course if you're thinking of becoming a member of our church or making this church your home. And so that's something you might want to consider. It's on the 2nd of July, 4 till 6 p.m. And you can book in. Details are on the screen.
Also, just want to point out something that was in our church bulletin last week, but just to highlight it, is that we are looking for an office manager to oversee and coordinate the work of the office here at the Free Church. So if you are interested, or if you think of someone who might be suitable for this, then do get in touch with us. The closing date is the end of June, and we're really praying that God will bring the right person to join the team here at the Free.
On Friday the 30th of June, church cricket team are playing a friendly game at Frinton Cricket Club in the evening, and there's an elite team of athletes put together for this match. You might want to come down and cheer us on. So the details again are on the screen.
And we wanted to say a huge thank you to everyone who has shown their support in the aftermath of the fire that took place just across the street from the church on Saturday night. I don't know if you want to add, Mark, because you were first on the scene, weren't you, on Saturday?
Not quite.
Evening. Almost.
just a huge thank you. Just talking to those who have been badly affected by that fire. They're so grateful for the support and prayers and care, very practical ways that people have looked after them. So thank you so much for how you've contributed towards that.
And if you'd still like to give towards the Compassion Fund to support those affected, that is still possible. We also wanted to let you know about the death of one of our church members, Andy Wright. Sadly passed away at the weekend. Andy had been ill for quite some time, but in the end, his death was quite sudden. And so we're particularly conscious of his family at this time. So let's pray now, in fact, for his family and for those affected by the fire last weekend. Father, we thank you that you are a good God and that you are a faithful God and that you are our refuge in times of trouble. And we thank you that how we've seen that in practice over the last week, in the aftermath of what happened at the weekend. Lord, we continue to pray for your blessing and provision for all those affected by the fire at the weekend as they recover and rebuild their lives. We pray that you will be their source of comfort. And we want to pray the same too for Andy's family, for Georgina and John and Billy, as they mourn the loss of their father, especially today. Lord, we want to pray that you would put your arms around them, that you would surround them with your love and with your peace and with your comfort. And we thank you that Andy is now at peace with you in glory. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like.
There is no one like you. There
We're going to read from Mark chapter 10, starting at verse 32. They were on their way up to Jerusalem with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. "We're going up to Jerusalem," he said, "and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise." Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. They replied, "Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory." "You don't know what you're asking," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they've been prepared." When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road.
So we are into the sort of second act of the book of Mark, and last week we said in this kind of act, in this middle part of the series, it's where Jesus starts to reveal the type of Messiah he is going to be. And here in Mark 10, we find Jesus revealing himself to be the Messiah who makes himself the last and the least, and also a Messiah who sees those who are the last and the least. So that's what we're going to be looking at today. In the passage that Sally read to us, we find James and John talking to Jesus, making a request from Jesus. James and John, the sons of thunder, as Jesus calls them. I've always thought that would make a great band name, wouldn't it? The sons of thunder. But here we see the sons of thunder, James and John, making this kind of very bold request of Jesus. They say, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." There's almost this sense that James and John are saying, "You know what, we've given up everything for you. We've been travelling with you, we've been serving you, joining you on your ministry. It's kind of payback time, Jesus. It's time to give us what we deserve, if you like. Give us what we want you to do, whatever we ask." And Jesus says, "What do you want me to do for you? And they reply, let us sit at your right hand and the other on your left. Now, it's quite a bold thing. James and John do get one thing right here in what they ask Jesus. They recognize that Jesus is kind of destined for glory, that one day he's going to be in his glory. And it's a good thing to get right, that they recognize that Jesus is a Messiah who one day is going to be glorified. Now, I wonder if you know this to be true, just as James and John did, that Jesus is king, that he's reigning over everything, that he's in his glory, that he is king, that he rules over the entire world, the entire universe. Now, do you know that to be true for yourself? Now, if you know it to be true, because you'll be following him. You know, if you know that someone is destined for glory, that they're going to be ruling and reigning, you would follow them. You would commit everything you have to them. Do you know Jesus as your king? Do you know that he's destined for glory? Are you following him with your whole life? James and John recognize that. They got it right, but they get quite a bit wrong here as well, as I'm sure that you understand. You see, James and John here completely misunderstand what Jesus is all about. Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? And they say, let us sit at your right hand and the other, your left, in glory. You see, they still think that Jesus the Messiah is going to come and have earthly glory, that he's here to, as a king, to kick out the Romans, that he's going to come with his army, that there's going to be a battle that eventually he will win, and that there's going to be glory and celebration on earth. They haven't understood Jesus's message from just moments before. If you look in chapter 10, verses 32 onwards, where Jesus describes what's going to happen to him. We touched on this last week, where Jesus explains that they're going to get to Jerusalem and he's going to be arrested. There's going to be mocking. He's going to be spat on. He's going to be beaten and flogged. And he's going to die. There will be glory. But Jesus says, you know, death comes first. And so Jesus kind of says to them, "Yeah, are you able to drink the cup that I drink from? Or are you ready to be baptized with the baptism that I'm going to be baptized with?" Kind of Jesus saying, do you know what you're asking really? Do you get it? Do you understand yet what's going to happen? And they say yes. I'm not sure they totally get what they're agreeing to. Jesus says, are you able to drink the cup that I'm going to drink from? Fast forward a little bit in Jesus' story, the night before, or the night he was arrested on. And you know, Jesus and his disciples, they're in Gethsemane, and Jesus goes off to pray on his own. And there's that agonizing moment. I love this piece of artwork here, but there's this agonizing moment where Jesus says, Father, Abba, you know, Daddy, Father, everything is possible for you. He says, take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but you will. You know, this cup that Jesus is praying about, the one he talks to James and John about, and the one that he prays about in Gethsemane, represents for him his death. It's this cup of bitterness, this cup of pain, that the death he's going to endure. It represents his crucifixion. It represents his suffering and his abandonment. So Jesus is saying to James and John, if you really want to rule with me, if you really want glory, what you're asking for is that you must die with me too. You must drink the same cup that I'm going to drink from. You must experience this agony, this suffering, this bitterness that I'm going to experience. You see, Jesus here as well sees his suffering and death as an immersion as well. He refers to it as being like a baptism. And, you know, the word baptized literally, it's not a spiritual word really. It just means to immerse something in water. You can baptize anything. You can plunge into water. And Jesus kind of says, you know, this suffering that he's going to go through, this death that he's going to go through, it's like an immersion. It's all around him. It's suffocating. He can't get away from it. James and John, he says, the pathway to glory in my kingdom is through suffering and death. Are you sure you can handle that, James and John? He's saying. And then as the story goes on, we see the other disciples, you know, have kind of been listening in on what's been going on. And we're told that they're indignant. You know, that's a posh way of saying they're really cheesed off with James and John. And so they start to kind of argue. In Luke 22, it actually describes them as arguing about who's the greatest among them. You know, they're saying, James and John, you shouldn't get the places of honour and glory next to Jesus. We should. We're better than you. How dare you be asking that? So they're arguing about who the greatest is. And so Jesus kind of says the same thing to them, but he uses different words. But kind of the same message. He says to all of the disciples together, look, the world chases after power and position. The world lords it over people and thinks they're the kind of the big cheese or the big shot. But he says, it's not going to be the same for you. It's not the same for my family. It's not the same for my disciples. Now, Jesus said to James and John, if you want glory, there's a road of suffering ahead of you. And to the rest of the disciples, he says, if you want to get on and if you want to be great, then you must be a servant. And if you want to be first, like James and John want to be first, here he says, you must be the slave of all. That's quite a statement, isn't it? You've got to be prepared to be the slave of all if you want the glory that you're seeking, if you want to be great. And what does the slave of all look like in Jesus' eyes? Well, he references his own death there as an example. Whoever wants to be first must be the slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He might as well have said, if you want to be first, you must be the slave of all. For example, I've come not to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. Jesus is the Messiah who makes himself the last and the least. Jesus is the Messiah who makes himself the slave of all, who walks that road. Yes, there is glory to come that James and John saw at the start. But first of all, there's miles and miles and miles of road, if you like, of suffering, of being the last and the least, of Jesus walking the road of being the slave of all. You know, in a culture that is completely built around the Roman Empire, the superpower of the day, a culture where there were just signs and symbols of what power looked like on their coins, on their buildings, you know, the bigger, the better, where there was Caesar, where there was an emperor. A culture, even the Jewish culture, that celebrated power to a certain extent as well, that the temple was enormous. A symbol of great power. The religious leaders in the Jewish community were powerful men. a group of disciples around him who wrestled and argued about who was the greatest and who was the most powerful. In amongst this Roman Empire, the Jewish culture, his own disciples, Jesus makes himself the last and the least. I don't think we kind of grasp the enormity of what Jesus is saying here and just how countercultural Jesus' language is here. You've got to be the slave of all. It's staggering that the one destined for glory is always looking for the lowest place. The one destined for glory says, I'm the slave of all. The one who is prepared to take that place of shame, the kind of dirty, smelliest position. You know, we even see that, don't we, as Jesus later on washes his disciples' feet. The lowest of the low jobs, the shameful job in any household in Jewish culture. Jesus takes that job on, allows himself to be beaten, flogged, mocked, spat on. Allows himself to take our shame onto himself on the cross, who dies in our place, the slave of all. It even jars as I say it, and Jesus is the slave of all. It doesn't feel right. But this is what he says he's all about. This is what it means for him to be the Messiah here. Completely countercultural. Completely at odds with the world around him and even his disciples who argue about greatness. And he says, whoever wants to follow me must do the same. Now I wonder, this is a question you want to ponder today and maybe over the following days. What does it look like for me to make myself the last and the least and the slave of all? What does it mean for me to follow Jesus as his disciple, walking that same road? Give some time over that, over the coming days. So Jesus reveals himself to be the Messiah who makes himself the last and the least, but also he's the Messiah who sees those who are last and the least. Now, Mark 10 is an interesting chapter because it kind of starts and ends with kind of the same story. They're different moments in time, but they've kind of got the same message. The start of Mark chapter 10, we see that there are people bringing children to see Jesus. And children were just totally disregarded in this culture at this time. They weren't really seen as important or special, not like we would care for children today at all. And so the disciples want to get the children away from Jesus. He doesn't want to be bothered with people like these children. And Jesus says, No, I see them. I see them. Let them come to me. At the end of Mark chapter 10, there's another story of somebody who's considered to be overlooked, who is the last and the least, who Jesus also sees and spots. It's a great story. When they came to Jericho, as Jesus and his disciples together with a large crowd were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus, son of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and said, call him. This is a wonderful encounter that Jesus has. It's my favourite story of Jesus. It's my favourite encounter that he has with an individual. And I love it because this story of Bartimaeus is the gospel in a nutshell, in a little moment in time, we see, I think, all of the gospel, all of the good news of Jesus being put on display. You see, Jesus in this story sees this man who is sitting in the gutter, who's begging, who's blind. He's unseen by kind of everybody else. He's unloved. He's unable to help himself at all. But this guy, Bartimaeus, first of all, recognizes who Jesus is. He says, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." You know, we've seen in Mark chapter 10 how few people recognize who Jesus is. Here, Bartimaeus, this beggar, recognizes who Jesus is. And everybody else tells him to be quiet. "Shut up, Bartimaeus. Get back in the gutter. You are nobody. Jesus isn't bothered with you. Sit down." But Bartimaeus' attitude here is wonderful. He shouts louder and Jesus sees him out of the crowd. He spots him. He sees him. And he heals him. He gives him his sight back. And then we see at the end of the story, Bartimaeus starts to follow Jesus on the road to Jerusalem. He becomes a disciple of Jesus. It's the gospel in a nutshell. You see, all of us are begging. All of us really are the last and the least. We're all caught up in our sin. We're unable to help ourselves. We are spiritually blind until we recognize who Jesus is, until we turn to him, until we call on Jesus for help. And in that moment, it's the gospel because Jesus sees us and he heals us of the biggest problem we've got, of our sin. And we become new people and we can follow him as his disciples on the road. It is a great story. If ever you need to share the gospel with someone, if ever you need to explain the difference that Jesus can make in your life, Mark chapter 10, the story of Bartimaeus, it's all there. But for us today, just as we begin to finish, the importance of this story about Bartimaeus is that he is seen by Jesus. Jesus is the Messiah who sees those who are the last and the least. Jesus makes himself the last and the least. And in doing so, he sees those who are the last and the least. You see, I think Jesus sees Bartimaeus so differently to anybody else because he knows exactly what it feels like to be the last and the least. Jesus has taken on the role of the slave of all. He knows what it is to suffer. He knows what it is to serve. He knows what it is to be bypassed by people. And in doing that, he sees Bartimaeus. He knows this man. He knows his story. Because he himself is the last and the least. And Jesus calls us to do the same. You see, when you and I, when Jesus' disciples, when we choose to walk the road of the last and the least too, I think it does something in us. Our eyes are opened to those people around us who everybody else would say are the last and the least. As we start to take that role on too, as we start to prefer others, as we start to push other people forward rather than ourselves, as we become the slave of all and serve, I think it does something in us that opens up our eyes to those who everybody else might overlook. You know, the thing is, it's in our human nature, isn't it? We're drawn to people who are like us. You know, if ever you've driven your car overseas, you'll know perhaps in France or in Europe, you know, when you see a number plate that's British, you kind of go, "Oh, they're us. They're from where we are." And you kind of notice them. All the other cars can drive past you, but you'll notice a British number plate on a car because they're like us. They're from the same place. Whether you meet somebody who supports the same sports team as you, there's that kind of affinity. Oh, do you know what? You know, you're a Fulham fan too. Great. You feel there's a connection with them. When you take the place of the last and the least, I think it starts to give you a deep connection with those who are the last and the least in our society. Philip Yancey, the Christian writer, said it does something that we almost put on grace-tinted glasses, that as soon as we become the last and the least and we take that role and we become a servant and the slave to all, it's like we put on glasses that are great grace-tinted and we start to see everybody as Jesus does. Philippians 2, incredible verses there at the start of Philippians chapter 2, puts it this way: do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but look at this, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. You know, in other words, in humility, become the last and the least. Serve others, put other people first. And then you'll know, Paul goes on to write this and it becomes incredibly challenging. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Wow, there's a challenge. Who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance of a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Have the same mindset as Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to unpack that. And to have the same mindset as Jesus Christ means to make ourselves nothing. Means to take on the nature of a servant or the slave of all. It means humbling ourselves. In other versions the Bible's written in the ESV, it says, rather than Jesus making himself nothing, it says that he emptied himself. He emptied himself. And we're called to do the same, to become the last and the least, just like Jesus is. But there's a sense of it here, as Paul writes as well, that this was a choice that Jesus made. You know, he made himself nothing. He emptied himself. He humbled himself. You see, this doesn't come naturally. This isn't in our human nature to do this. Our human nature is what James and John said. Push yourself forward. Look for glory. Look to be not the slave of all, but the king of all, the queen of all. Jesus calls us to a different way of life. Making ourselves nothing. Emptying ourselves. Taking on the role of a servant. Humbling ourselves. Why? Because when we do this, we become more like Jesus, because this is the person he was. And secondly, we start to see people the way he does. As we make ourselves the last and the least, we start to see the last and the least around us. We start to see the Bartimaeuses who are bullied, who are downtrodden, who are overlooked, who are told by society to shut up and be quiet and know their place. We start to see them because we're drawn to them, because they're like us. In New York, there's a famous church called the Brooklyn Tabernacle. And a few years ago, that church was led by a man called Jim Cimbala, incredible pastor, incredible author. And Jim Cimbala, in one of his books, tells a story about an encounter that he had one Easter Sunday with a homeless man who came into his church. He says, after the final service one Easter Sunday, he felt exhausted and he took a seat on the edge of the stage just to grab his breath. That's how pastors feel at the end of Easter Sunday. We're shattered. And kind of as he was getting ready to go home and kind of finish for the day, he looks up and he sees a man with matted hair and ragged clothing walking towards him. As he drew closer, the homeless man offered a crooked grin, revealing two missing front teeth. And his smell, alcohol, sweat, urine, garbage, it took Jim's breath away. Though Jim had worked with the homeless countless times before, this stench was worse than anything he had ever encountered. Instinct compelled him to turn his face away, to take a breath of clean air before looking at the man and looking at him in his eyes again. Jim found himself asking this man his story and found out that his name was David. And David shared that he'd been living in an abandoned truck for 6 years. Jim knew where the story was heading and reached for his wallet and his money in his back pocket. David protested the offer. He didn't want money. He wanted Jesus. Jim describes closing his eyes and asking for God's forgiveness. He felt soiled and cheap. Though Jim was a pastor, he'd wanted to get rid of the homeless man as fast as possible. This precious individual crying out for a relationship with Christ, the Saviour whose good news Jim had preached all day. The man buried his filthy face in Jim's chest. Jim talked about Jesus' love, but rather than just saying the words, they were alive inside of him. The odour that had turned his stomach now became the loveliest fragrance and perfume he had ever smelt. Jim felt as if Jesus was saying, "Jim, if you and your wife have any value to me, if you have any purpose in my work, it has to do with this odour. This is the smell of the world I died for." I find that story just incredibly challenging, incredibly powerful. These people who so often we will ignore, that we're trying to avoid, that we'll overlook, the Bartimaeuses of the world. Jesus says, these are the people they die to. Their smell that can be so gut-wrenching sometimes is the smell, is the odour of the world that I died for. Jesus makes himself the last and the least, so that he can serve the last and the least. And he says, if you've got anything to do with my mission, if you've got anything to do with my world and my kingdom, make yourself the last and the least, so that you can see these people and you can serve them as I do. Let's pray together, shall we? And just in the quiet for a moment, just begin to reflect back on all that we've looked at today. And maybe just tell Jesus, this is what I've heard you saying to me. Jesus, this is what I've heard you saying to me. And we ask, Holy Spirit, that you'll come and work in our lives now. Jesus, I want to choose the same mindset that you have. Come, Holy Spirit, work in my life. Show me what it is to empty myself, to humble myself. Show us what it means to be the slave of all, to be the last and the least, just as you were, Jesus. We choose to walk the same road as you. Come, Holy Spirit, would you reshape my attitude and responses to people around me? I confess that so often I strive and I push for glory and greatness, whatever that might look like. But come, Holy Spirit, reshape and renew my attitude and responses. Help us to wear grace-tinted glasses, to see people the way that you do. Come, Holy Spirit, would you recalibrate me for Jesus' kingdom, to be a disciple of his, so that I respond to people and situations as you do. Jesus, you are our Messiah who made himself the last and the least so that you would see the last and the least. I choose to do the same. Amen.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living home. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that tell the promise. Your buried body began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. And Jesus, yours is the victory. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name.
So thank you so much for choosing to be part of Sunday Online this week. As Sally and I will often say, it's great to hear from you. So do get in touch with us. Let us know how life's going and anything we can be praying for, any comments on what we're looking at the moment. It's always just so encouraging. You are so much a part of our church, even if you can't always be present with us. And we do appreciate the fact that you tune in all the time. And just pray that you have a blessed week as you go on, as you follow Jesus as one of his disciples.